Well, good morning and welcome to the Bridge. A few quick announcements before we get started with worship this morning. First off, for you men out here, somebody left their keys in a men's bathroom. So, leather tag. What we're going to do is I'm just going to sit them up here in front by Nick so you don't have to claim them this second, but let you know that your car keys are there if you're looking for them. Oh, James. Brother James. There you go, brother. He didn't want to wait till after service. Come and get those keys. Two quick announcements. Thursday evening, again at 7 o'clock, prayer meeting up here at church for anybody who's interested. It's corporate prayer meeting, and we actually have a time of prayer as a whole group and then split out into some small groups. We actually get to walk the grounds and pray over different parts of the building, different ministries. That's a great time every week. So that's open to anybody who would like to come. And then on Wednesday, July 8th, we are going to be having the Ignite Middle School Youth Choir. For those of you who came to hear Encounter, this is kind of the training grounds for Encounter, if you will. They're based out of Godfrey Methodist, United Methodist Church, out on Airport Road. Debbie Canyo, who has been in the school district, is a music teacher for years, was an Encounter director for years, is their director. They do a great job. So mark that on your calendar, Wednesday night, July 8th, Ignite, the middle school choir, Christian choir, is going to be coming here to sing. And we want to support them, just like we do Encounter. Those are great ministries that those kids do around the area. So let's go ahead and mark our calendars for that. Nick's going to give us a call to worship, and then we'll join together in song.
How's everybody doing?
Yeah.
You know, in the corporate world, we all are familiar with the term working your way up the ladder, right? Well, today in the scripture that we're going to look at, just the opposite is true. It's almost like we are being called to work our way down the ladder. And what I mean by that is, in Christianity, it's very opposite of most religions. In the fact that, just a few examples, in order to be blessed, you must first be a blessing, right? In order to be loved, you must first love. In order to lead, you must be a servant. So it's almost like we're working our way down the ladder. And in Philippians 2, 5 through 11, which Stephen will be preaching on this morning, Paul vividly paints that picture for us and shows us how to live that life, that servant attitude life, and the way that we are to work our way down the ladder. So this is going to be kind of a weird prayer that I have for you guys this morning, but as we stand and begin to worship, my prayer is that you see today how to work your way down that ladder. Because ultimately, at the bottom of that ladder, just like at the bottom, the foot of the cross, Jesus is there waiting to help us live through that life. So let's stand and worship this morning.
All right. We're going to start this morning with This Is Amazing Grace, one that everybody knows. I want to hear you sing it out, and let's worship Him this morning.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings.
Who shakes the whole earth?
Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You'd lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Who rules the nations?
Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shine like the sun in all of its brilliance. the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Sing it out now.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Amen. Lift it up to him this morning. Amen. It is amazing grace when you think about it, what he did, sending his only son here to die for us. And the next song really speaks to that. Mighty to Save is what we're going to sing. I love the beginning, first few lyrics. Everyone, you think about what's been going on the last couple weeks in this country and in our world. Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, and the hope of nations. Boy, he is the hope of nations. Amen? Amen. So let's sing this together.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures, and fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever the author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. Singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world sing. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. And Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation.
grave. Jesus conquered the sin. That again, Savior, Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. The author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Amen.
At this time, we are going to dismiss the little kids from birth all the way through fifth grade. We're going to let them go back and hear a lesson customized to parallel what Steve's talking about today in his message. So as they're leaving and finding their way to their classroom and to their teacher, let's take a moment and just lift them up in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you so very, very much for the blessings we have at the Bridge, for our church and for our children's church workers and teachers, that they take the time and that you've blessed them with the knowledge to transform those messages into a way that they can understand. Now keep them safe, let them be attentive, and let it all touch their hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Mark chapter 10, verse 45, short verse, but one that speaks a lot of truth. Goes like this: for even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. That's one message for us, right? But then to complete that, and to give His life as a ransom for many. We think about that word ransom, a price paid to buy back or bring about release from some obligation or undesirable circumstance. So if you think about what that means to us and the undesirable circumstance that we're in as sinners. And we're all sinners, right? I am. I point it right back at me. And Jesus paid that ransom. And as we sing Jesus Messiah, part of that chorus, the rescue for sinners, the ransom for from heaven, and we need to remember that. Let's go ahead and join together as we sing Jesus Messiah.
Sin, who knew no sin, that we might become His righteousness. He humbled Himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing.
Let's lift it up to Him. Jesus Messiah.
Jesus Messiah, the name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from hell. Jesus Messiah, your Lord of all. His body the bread, His blood the wine, broken and poured out all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so amazing. Love so amazing.
Now let's sing it like we think it's amazing.
Jesus Messiah, the name above all names, your blessed sinners, the ransom from heaven, name above all names. Blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer.
Father, all glory goes to you. You're so good. We thank you for all that you are and all that you've done for us. The fact that you sent your one and only Son with all the power that he had, he came and humbled himself for us. Praise be to you, Jesus. We thank you. We thank you for the love, the steadfast and forever love that you hold for us. And Lord, may we love you the best that we can. Father, as we come here to you today, we just pray that you do something just miraculous to our hearts. This truth that we're about to hear today, that Stephen, that you're going to speak through him, may it just fill our hearts with joy, and just may that joy overflow so that others may be curious and wonder and, Lord, ultimately see you through us. So, Father, I just pray that you use Stephen boldly, and may this message just captivate our hearts and grip us so that we may just get to know you and love you more. So, Father, we just thank you. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. As we continue to contemplate this blessed Redeemer, this rescue for sinners, this hope of the world, Jesus is that hope of the world. But one thing that is interesting, if you're anything like me at all, then you go through just kind of sputters, and I don't even know that that's the right word. You spin your tires sometimes emotionally, and things become sometimes overwhelming, and you kind of wonder, do I have what it takes? And then you kind of wonder, God, are you there? And often that takes place in the midst of tough times. There was this guy that most of us are familiar with, hopefully. In fact, we talked about him a lot this past fall. His name was Moses. And Moses was a pretty big head honcho leader. He was very important for Israel. And after Moses died, Joshua was appointed to be the new leader of Israel. And Joshua realized that these were shoes that he was unable to fill. And in my mind, Joshua's pacing back and forth and going, I can't do it, I can't do it, I can't do it, I can't do it. Perhaps you've had a moment like that. You're actually right when you say that. You can't do it. But the good news is, two of the best words in the Bible are, but God. And God enters into Joshua's life, and Joshua hears God say this in Joshua 1:9, have I not commanded you? That's pretty strong, right? Like, this is God Almighty on his throne, and now he's asking Joshua a question. Have I not commanded you? This is not, Here's a suggestion for you, Joshua. Here's maybe a good idea. God is saying here to Joshua, have I not commanded you? And then it goes on, be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened and do not be dismayed. Why? For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Now to Philippians. Paul is in a jail cell when he writes this letter to this church in Philippi. And the Philippian believers at this church, apparently some of them are not getting along with one another very well. I'm sure that you get along always extremely well with everyone that comes into your sphere of influence, and you just can't identify with this. That just no bumps in the road with your relationships with other people, right? This was just this crazy group in Philippi. They just couldn't get it together. Paul has shown them in the first four verses of Philippians chapter 2 that they need to be united, but in order to have true unity, they have to be humble. And they need to think about each other more than they would even think of themselves. And last week's message was really highlighting the fact, what would it look like if we treated other people like kings and queens and created in God's image and revered them as people that are in the image of God? And Paul spun his tires for a little while, and then he went, I got it. It's Jesus. Jesus did this. And in Philippians 2, 5, 3, 11, we have possibly the six strongest verses compacted together about what Jesus did. This is God's word to us today. Philippians 2, beginning with verse 5, says this. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Let's pray together. Father, these words, may they grip our hearts, may they transform us, may your mind and your motivations be at work in us and your people here. We need you, and you are better than we could ever imagine or comprehend. May you do a work in us now, so that we may see your Son high and lifted up and watch him draw us closer to you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This has never happened to me, and maybe this hasn't happened to you either, but I've seen in TV shows and movies, and probably my favorite one is, Robinson Crusoe, I think. Wasn't there a movie about that? And they're on the stranded island. Help me out here. You guys are so good. You're really helping. You're really trying. And I'm not describing the movie very well, okay? But Gilligan's Island? It's not Gilligan's Island. But okay, and this isn't, This isn't all of a sudden. So let me describe the scene, and then maybe you guys can come up with the movie. And I watched it as a kid, and there's this tiger or lion or something, and they figure out how to trap this tiger or lion. Swiss Family Robinson, right? Swiss Family Robinson. And that took a while, right? This is going somewhere, but this was kind of an off-the-cuff illustration here. And the big cat, I forgot if it was a lion or a tiger. Tiger? And it falls in to this pit because they've covered up the pit with all this grass, and it can't get out of the pit. And I just kind of have imagined then, you know, what would happen if, like, you're just walking, you know, maybe through the woods or whatever, and there's this covered up pit, and whoosh, boom, you're in there. And there's no way that you can get yourself out of this pit. And unless someone acts on your behalf, you have no hope and there is no help for you. So before the foundation of the world, before the world was created, okay, you have God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit, and some of you maybe already are going, no, Stephen, because God the Son, that was Christmas. That was after the world was created. That was when Jesus became both God and man. But Jesus existed with God the Father and God the Holy Spirit before the foundation of the world. And before the world was created, God, in his infinite wisdom of knowing the end from the beginning, knew that you and I were going to fall into a pit that we could not get ourselves out of. Before anything else, God knew that about us. And here's the amazing thing. He chose to create us anyway. Some of us may have this attitude of, well, gee, if it's going to bomb, if it's going to fail, if it's not going to work, then I'm just not even going to do it. And here's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit speaking the world into existence. And as this world is being spoken to existence, knowing, now here's the crazy thing. It's one thing if you accidentally fall into a hole that you can't get yourself out of. But it's another thing if your heavenly Father has told you that there is one road by which you should not travel. And if you travel this road, you are going to fall into a pit and you will not be able to get yourself out of it. And then you look at your heavenly Father and go, oh, come on, you're spoiling all my fun. That road down there, it looks really good. And I know better. So I'm going to go down that road because I like what's down that road. And then you fall into that pit. This is not something that happened to us as human beings accidentally. This is something that happened to us because we thought we knew better than the God who created us. Now, I am not the disciplinarian in my home. Some of you that know me well probably aren't that surprised about that. My wife knows how to lay down the law, not only with our children, but also sometimes with me, and I thank God for her. But if my child at some point is going down a direction and going down a road that they're not supposed to go down, it is initially my temptation to jump in and say, no, don't do that. And you know what? That's kind of what God did too. Because all throughout the Old Testament, you have him speaking through prophets and him writing down the word and saying, no, don't go there. And the crazy thing that all of us, as part of the human race, has basically just pushed God out of the way and said, no, because I am hell-bent on going to hell. Because I think I know better. Now, Of course, you probably don't really say, I'm hell-bent on going to hell, because that's, you know, the road to hell is paved with good intentions of thinking that you know what's best and thinking that you are going to be able to make it for yourself, right? But that's the direction. But after, and there was one moment where I told Benny not to do something and he did it anyway and he did get hurt and I knew it wasn't one of these things where he needed to go to the hospital, and I just kind of sat back and went, all right, he's going to have to learn. He can't do that. So God has this sense as a Heavenly Father, there are certain things you got to learn. You can't do that. But in the midst of our rebellion against God, God does not sit on his throne and twiddle his thumbs and go, boy, they've made a mess of it, and I'm just going to keep them in that pit. God is a missionary God who acts on our behalf. And he is the one who has initiated salvation. You did not all of a sudden wake up one day and decide, I'm going to get right with God. God has orchestrated every single event in your life to bring you to a point where you bow your knee to him. And some of you may not be there yet, but based on this passage of scripture, here's the truth that's here. One day, you are going to bow your knee to Jesus. Why not make that day today? Now, some of you have said, well, I did bow my knee to Jesus, and I have said, well, I did that. Here's my issue. I can bow my knee one moment, and the next moment get up and not think that I need to stay on my knees. So there is this sense in which Paul is saying, I want you to see the beauty and grandeur of Jesus in such a way that it becomes your joy to bow your knee to Jesus, and it becomes your joy to confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord. How's that work? It's been said that, I had one of these in college, and there's these bracelets that say WWJD, stands for What Would Jesus Do? And a lot of us, it kind of was sort of faddish, actually. And I'm usually pride myself on not really jumping into fads, but I did jump into this one, and we're all thinking, well, what would Jesus do? Well, what would Jesus do? And that's not always the best question, because in a lot of situations, I don't really know what Jesus would do. And according to the Gospels, he was constantly baffling the disciples. The disciples had all these predictable ideas of like, oh, this is what Jesus is going to do in this situation. And he always threw them curveballs and always went a different direction. So maybe what did Jesus do is a better question than what would Jesus do. We do have some things recorded in Scripture and the Gospels that Jesus actually did do. And we might be able to, if you ever reverse engineered to try to get the right math problem, you know, there's answers in the back of some of those math books, and you can actually look at the answer when you can't figure it out, and then you can actually go back and try to figure out the answer. Mrs. Guyman probably doesn't want anybody to know that. Most of us have already been through math, and we're probably, some of us, very thankful we don't ever have to take another math class in our lives. I'll be quiet now. Sorry, those of you who love math. But what does Paul want us to do? He doesn't say, ultimately, be like Jesus. Because you know what that command does? It sets you and I up for failure. We cannot be like Jesus. what Paul tells these believers in Philippi to do is look at Jesus. And there's this amazing thing that I've read about that as a married couple gets older with one another, that after a while you begin to actually resemble, you start looking alike. I'm not really sure that that's true. I'm not that old yet, sorry. But there's this sense in which, and I don't know, maybe, anyway, maybe a bad illustration, okay? But I do believe that Scripture teaches that the one that looks to Jesus and looks at Jesus and is amazed at the beauty of Jesus will begin to look more like him, will begin to think more like him, will begin to feel more like how he feels. So we have this hummingbird feeder outside our kitchen window that is really a lot of fun, and hummingbirds really, they like communicate to one another, I guess, that there's food there. And there's multiple hummingbirds that usually one at a time, but they come often. And my kids say, oh, a hummingbird. And sometimes, because they're quick, you know, and it doesn't take much for them to fly away again. But at one point, Sophie was trying to describe a hummingbird. And the beauty of the hummingbird, and finally she just said, You just need to see it next time. And that's how I feel with the sermon, guys, if I'm totally honest. What is portrayed in this part of the Bible, I know I can't do justice to. What I can do to all of you and say to all of you is this Jesus who Paul is writing about here, you need to see him. You don't need to see me. You don't need to hear me even so much. You need to see this Jesus. Here's the beauty of God. God wants you to see him. Remember, right now we're still in the pit, okay? And we can't fall out. We're stuck there. And here's God looking and seeing all of us in that pit and turning to his son and saying, all right, boy, go get my people. Go and get my people. How did it happen? Look at verse 6. Jesus, though he was in the form of God, and let's stop there. What this part says here is that Jesus is God. There are a lot of people that want to say that Jesus was a good teacher, that Jesus was a prophet, that Jesus did some really good things. But the thing is, according to John 8, Jesus never said that about himself. And here's the thing. The Pharisees that were the religious leaders of the day that had all of the theological education, they understood what Jesus was saying. And it made them so mad that they came up with a plot to try to kill him. Because if Jesus was just saying he was a rabbi or a prophet or a good teacher, they would have patted him on the back and said, okay, cool, I like some of your teachings. But at one point, Jesus tells these Pharisees, hey, you are children of the devil. Not a great way to make friends. And they get a little bit upset with him, and then their response to Jesus is, how dare you call us children of the devil? We are children of Abraham. And Jesus says, no, you're not. Because if you were genuinely children of Abraham, then you would, like Abraham was, long for my coming and my appearing, and now I am here, and you are trying to kill me. I said, what are you talking about, Jesus? You're this young guy. How can you say you know all this stuff about Abraham? And then Jesus says, before Abraham was, I am. Before Abraham was, I am. Jesus' claim And that part of the Gospels says, before the world was in existence, I was with God the Father and God the Holy Spirit, and now I have come down to enter earth. It was at that point that the Pharisees picked up stones and wanted to kill him. They didn't want to kill him whenever he said to them, "You're children of the devil." But after Jesus said, "I am God in the flesh," that's when they're ready to throw stones at him. The very beginning of this sermon, I read Joshua 1:9. What does it mean for the fact that Jesus really is God? It is supposed to give believers courage. You know what Jesus being God means? If Jesus is God and he died on the cross and he rose from the dead and now he's seated right here at the right hand of God, what that means is there's not a bird that falls from the sky that he doesn't know about. There's not a hair that falls from your head and some more than others that he does not know about. There's not a lightning bolt that flashes that he does not control and command. He is in charge. He is in control. Not only is he in the form of God, but he did not think equality with God was something to be grasped. So he comes down to become not just God, but also God and man. And then it says he made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant. In our Tuesday morning men's Bible study, we read this passage and someone mentioned the show Undercover Boss. And if you're familiar with Undercover Boss, you have these CEOs of big companies that go in disguised as your normal, like I watched one on 7-Eleven, and they've got the 7-Eleven, you know, gear, and they're making coffee, and they're, you know, and that Jesus comes down to earth. And what did he do? He made himself a servant. No passage of scripture does justice to this quite like the one in John 13. Right before Jesus and the disciples take the Lord's Supper, someone there has to wash the disciples' feet. I know it would be kind of weird if you went to someone's home today and they asked you to take off your shoes and someone washed your feet. But back then it made a whole lot more sense because there weren't gravel roads and you shared roads with donkeys, and donkeys sometimes drop presents on the road, and sometimes you don't know where you're going, or you step into something and you didn't wear socks and you didn't have the shoes that we have today. So these are really stinky feet and it's really gross. And in the upper room with the disciples, often someone that was the host would have a servant, and the lowest servant would go with a hand towel and a bowl of water and wash the feet. And after a while, all the disciples are waiting. And after a while, they're like, "No way, Jesus forgot to call the servant to wash our feet." And then proper protocol then called for whichever one of these disciples was lowest on the totem pole, they're the one that's supposed to get up and take the bowl of water and the hand towel and wash the feet. And if the disciples were anything like me, I'm thinking, okay, I'm not the best disciple, but I'm not number 12. So I don't need to do this. Someone else will do this for me. And then Jesus takes off his outer garment, grabs the bowl, grabs the towel, and begins to wash each disciple's feet. Now, the disciples, with their pride, they were thinking, "I'm not the worst," but they knew this: Jesus was the best in their midst. So when Jesus gets to Peter, and we know this probably, Peter goes, "No, no, no, no. Don't you wash my feet, Jesus." And Jesus looks at Peter and says, "Peter, if I don't wash your feet, you have no part of me." And then Peter, being Peter, says, okay then, Jesus, not just my feet, but my hands and my body as well. Wash me completely. What's this teaching? Jesus is saying here, unless you are realizing that you are in a pit and you cannot get yourself out, and that I have gone down into the pit to lift you up, then you are not with me and you do not know me. As long as you think that you are able to save yourself, help yourself, do it yourself, Jesus takes a step back and says, okay, let's see how that goes for you. But Jesus, who came to serve, says, the serving that I have come to do is the serving that will lead to your salvation. But you have to be humble enough to realize that you need it. Not only did he serve by washing the disciples' feet, it goes on to say, he was found in human form, and he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. The Jew who died on the cross was considered cursed by God. And Jesus was cursed in your place and in my place so we could be blessed by God. Someone wrote that the only way you die with outstretched hands is on the cross. And he uses this illusion as Jesus is dying, he is opening up his arms to those who realize they need him. There is the sense in which this, as Nick shared, the way up for the Christian is really the way down. Because what Paul's saying now is, you need to have that same attitude and same mindset at work in your heart and in your life as well. That's not the end of the story, thank goodness. Verse 9 says, therefore God gave him the name above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. What's that mean for implications for us today? How do we look to Jesus in a situation like this? First of all, this is simple, but it will change the way you live, I believe. Jesus came as a man. Jesus came in a body. Jesus came as a human being. What's that mean? That means that Jesus ate food and enjoyed it. That means that Jesus listened to birds sing and delighted in it. That means that Jesus worked with his hands and enjoyed the work of his hands. There are Christians, and there's a saying out there, and I'm not going to, because I know the intention is good, okay? But we just need to go out there and just save souls. Well, yes, I want to see souls saved, but it's a whole lot more than just the soul. Because we are a soul and a body. We are both. And there was this, should I go there, should I not? There's this heretical teaching out there called Gnosticism, where basically there were people that taught that everything that's physical is bad and only the spiritual matters. And Jesus' incarnation, Jesus becoming a human being, speaks against that false teaching, to where he says, no, the physical is good. And here's the craziest thing. When Jesus rose from the dead, guess what? He had a physical body still. He was able to be touched. He ate fish. Now, granted, he also walked through walls. And he also kind of did this Star Trek beam me up Scotty thing where he's there and then he's not there. And that tells me something about our bodies maybe don't work the way that they were intended to. Maybe one of the curses of sin, and our new and improved body, maybe we'll get to walk through walls. But thank God we're going to be able to eat still and hug and experience things that matter. So what's that mean for you and I? It means when you eat lunch after this church service, eat that lunch unto the glory of God. When you hug a loved one, recognize that that hug matters. What else does it mean? It means that if Jesus was a human being, it means that he experienced the wide range of emotions that you and I experience, yet was without sin. Did Jesus understand betrayal? Do you know the story of Judas? Did Jesus understand loss of a loved one? Remember Lazarus? Did Jesus understand what it meant to probably hit the hammer and stub his finger and be tempted to say a colorful word? He understood all of those things. And the Bible says that he's able to identify with everything that you and I go through because he lived it just like we did. Yet he never sinned. What else does it mean? It means that Jesus died in your place and in mine so that we would never have to experience eternal separation from God. And then where is Jesus now? The Bible says that he sits right beside his Father and he reigns on high. There is a lot that is wrong with our world. There is a lot that is not as it should be. But this is a glimpse here to the end of the story. That one day, every wrong will be righted, every tear will be wiped away, and Jesus will experience glory in the way that every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. What's that mean? That means that God doesn't want to see you continue in a pit. God wants to come when you have rebelled against him in the form of his Son and stoop down and pull you up. And as he stoops down and pulls you up, Psalm 40, some of my favorite verses in the Bible, says this: I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and mire, and he set my feet on a rock. Guess what? Rocks don't move. Rocks are not sinking sand. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Which is another thing this passage teaches. Just as Jesus is the solid rock, only Jesus has the name that is above every name. And only at the name of Jesus is there salvation. And only at the name of Jesus will every knee bow and every tongue confess. Some people look at that and go, well, that's my biggest beef with Christianity. That's my biggest beef with this whole thing. They're so exclusive that they got to say, it's Jesus, it's Jesus, it's Jesus, it's only Jesus. That's my beef with them. It ought to also be all these other things too. God has one son. I have one son. I want people to know my son. I'm proud of my son. But my son is capable of mischief and sin. And my son can't save you. God's son, his one and only son, he is proud of. and he has not committed mischief or sin. And he can save you and bring hope and healing and truth and forgiveness and everything that your heart longs for. So God says, look at my son. Because God wants us to look at the best and not just an option that is a dead-end road that leads to nowhere. Final part. I like the movie Finding Nemo. I like the whole movie. I'm looking forward to Finding Nemo 2. They keep telling me it's coming out soon. I haven't heard an update. But one of my favorite parts of the movie Finding Nemo is whenever the dad of Nemo, Marlin, is that right? I just told you I like this movie and I don't remember the name. Anyway, the dad has found the son and been reunited with the son, which, by the way, guys, the whole storyline of Finding Nemo, son doesn't listen to dad, okay? And swims farther out than he should. And what's dad do? Dad, who's scared to death of the ocean, goes for miles and miles on end and faces sharks and these creepy creatures in the deep and all this stuff, all for the sake of finding his son and bringing his son back safely. That's the gospel. That's one reason why I love the movie. But here's the really cool thing that I love. Whenever Dory is in this big net, if you haven't seen this movie, just check it out, okay? And there's all these big, dumb fish in the net. And Nemo has this great idea about encouraging all these dumb fish to swim down because it'll break the rope that holds the net and they'll all get free. So Nemo says, no, Dad, don't worry, because Nemo can get out of the net. He can free himself. And his dad says, son, just free yourself. Just get out of here. And Nemo says, no, I can save Dory. I can save everybody. They just need to listen to me. So Nemo says, everyone swim down. Everyone swim down. And then Nemo's dad starts saying, listen, you fish. Listen to my son. Swim down. Swim down. Didn't you hear what my son was saying? That's what God, our Father, is telling you and I today. Because his son that could have escaped the prison of the net chose not to in order to save us. And God the Father is saying, listen to my son. What does the Son of God say? I am the way and the truth and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through me. If you are trusting in anything else for your salvation, you are standing on sinking sand. And you are headed down a dead-end street. God the Father is saying to you, listen to my son. He's the way and the truth and the life. And one day, everyone will know it. And one day, everyone will say it. Even the demons under the earth. Let's pray. Father, thank you for speaking to us today. Thank you for exhorting us to listen to your son. May we treasure him. And may we pray through this next song. And may the prayer of our hearts and our minds, our feelings, our emotions, even our body, may it cry out, give me Jesus. It's in his name and for his fame and glory we pray. Amen. One of my favorite songs is a song we're going to be able to sing now. It's called Give Me Jesus. That's right, right. And it is the Father's will that you would pray, give me Jesus. And as you pray, give me Jesus, Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, will come and bring forgiveness and healing and hope and strength and abundant life to you. Even when you were in the pit, just cry out, give me Jesus. And he will come and he will speak to your heart as though he's known you forever, because he has known you forever and he has loved you forever. May we pray and sing, give me Jesus. Let's stand.
In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, just give me Jesus. When I am alone, when I am alone, oh, when I am alone, give me
that song. I love more than anything about it that it could be an infinite number of verses. When I go to work, give me Jesus. When I'm dealing with relationship problems, give me Jesus. When I have financial struggles, give me Jesus. If I'm sick, give me Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
And all those things that I just said, they're all things of this earth, right? And we got to remember what Jesus is here for. He's here as a friend now, but he's here as a savior for later. Amen? We need to remember that. And especially as we sing this last song, The Wonderful Cross. You know, crosses weren't meant to be wonderful, were they? They were meant to be totally the opposite. But we know what he did for us on that cross. It makes it wonderful for us. So let's sing this together this morning.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss, and pour contempt on all my
your name. Let's sing that again. Lift it up.
Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross bids me come and die and find that I may truly live.
Sing it out now.
Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. All who gather here, by grace draw near and bless. bless your name.
Amen. Lift it up to him this morning. Great time of worship this morning. Amen.
Listening to the Son of God, there's no one who speaks like he does. There's no one that has the balance of truth and love like he does. And I've discovered that sometimes my radio isn't tuned in. And what I've discovered when my radio is not tuned in to hearing well from the Son of God, that's where all of you come into play. To bring help and encouragement and strength. And God has made us to where we need each other and we need help. So the beauty is God can speak to you and you can share what God says to you with someone else. And in that, by golly, God may speak to the person you just shared with. So next week, preview of Coming Attractions, Paul gets very practical in how looking to Jesus plays out in our lives. Okay? Bible says we're supposed to work this out with fear and trembling. We're supposed to always be in awe of Jesus' salvation. And then are you ready? Here's a big one. This is going to bring everybody back, and you can also bring somebody with you next week, even though it's 4th of July weekend. One of the most interesting verses in the Bible, Philippians 2:14, says this, "Do everything without complaining or arguing." Really down-to-earth practical, right? Do everything without complaining or arguing. If you complain and if you argue, you need to come back next week so we can all figure out how God can help us be freed from complaining and arguing, okay? And that's just one simple, practical way that continuing to look to Christ and continuing to look to him brings hope and strength and help. So I want to invite you back next week. If God spoke to you today, there are these cards in the pews, and you can drop those in the offering baskets on your way out the door. It's always good to hear how God speaks to us. We'll receive the benediction, and outstretched arms is a great way to acknowledge our need for God. And now, God, to you, who sent your one and only Son, who lived a life we could never live, died a death we deserve, conquered death, rose from the dead, forgiving sin, removing our sins, as far as the east is from the west. God, may you enable us and empower us to hear your Son speak and give us courage and strength that when your Son speaks, we will listen and obey. It's in Jesus' name and for his glory we pray. Amen. 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 May you go with God's grace and peace.